So hello students, today I am here with second module of your continuing chapter solid state. In first module I had told you that what are solids, how they are classified. Solids are mainly classified into two categories, one in as crystalline solids and amorphous solids. Crystalline solids and amorphous solids. Further, crystalline solids are classified into four categories depending on the nature of constituent particle present and the nature of forces that are operating between them. So from here onwards we will continue the chapter. So solids are of two types, amorphous and crystalline. As you know that I had already explained the difference between these two terms. Amorphous solids are those solids in which constituent particles are randomly arranged. They are not arranged in an orderly manner. And in crystalline solids, different constituent particles, they are arranged in a perfect orderly geometrical pattern. Now these crystalline solids are further classified into four categories on the basis of type of particle present and nature of forces that are operating between them. So they are further classified as molecular solids, ionic solids, covalent solids and metallic solids. Now the parameter for this classification is the nature of constituent particle. Now for any matter, we had already explained you that matter is made up of very small particles, and these particles could be atoms, could be molecules, could be ions. So once we say particle, we are referring to one of them. When I say a particle, that means that could be an atom, that could be a molecule, or that could be a ion. So on the basis of nature of particles and nature of forces that are operating between them, these crystalline solids are further classified into these four categories: molecular solids, ionic solids, covalent solids and metallic solids. Let us see one by one. In molecular solids, constituent particles are molecules. And depending on the nature of molecule, the type of force may be van der Waal force, may be a dipole-dipole interaction or hydrogen bond. So these molecular solids, they themselves are of three types: polar, non-polar or hydrogen bonded. If the nature of molecule is polar, then it is a polar molecular solid, and nature of interactions between them is dipole-dipole interaction, like solid sulfur dioxide. If nature of molecule is non-polar, then it is a non-polar molecular solid, and nature of force is van der Waals force, like iodine molecule. But as you know that if hydrogen is bonded with oxygen, sulfur or fluorine, then there is hydrogen bonding. So if the molecule has got the conditions to fulfill for hydrogen bonding, then it is hydrogen bonded solid, like ice. Now we come to this, ionic compounds. Ionic crystalline solids, the constituent particles are ions. These positively and negatively charged ions, and they are held together with Coulombic forces or electrostatic forces of attraction. Then third we come to the covalent solid or network solids. These network solids, their constituent particles are atoms, and that are held together by covalent bonds. And in metallic solids, their positively charged metal ions are immersed in sea of electrons, and again electrostatic force of attraction between these positively charged ion and negatively charged sea of electrons holds them together. So this is the classification of different type of solids. So before I proceed further, let me take this opportunity to revise the things that I had already discussed with you. Solids are characterized by their fixed shape and fixed volume. In case of solids, particles are packed very closely, their intermolecular spaces are very less, and intermolecular forces of attraction are very, very strong. Molecular motion is not allowed. Particles can only vibrate along their mean positions. Now these solids are further classified into two categories depending on the nature of arrangement of constituent particles. If these particles are perfectly or orderly arranged, then it is called a crystalline solids, and if these constituent particles has got a random arrangement, then it is called an amorphous solid. Now these crystalline solids are further classified into four different categories depending on the nature of constituent particle and nature of force that is operating between them. If constituent particles are molecules, then they are called molecular solids. Then these molecular solids could be further a polar molecular solid, a non-polar molecular solid, or a hydrogen bonded molecular solid. If we talk of ionic solids, here constituent particles are positively and negatively charged ions, cation and anion. They are the constituent particles, and obviously these ions are held together with the help of very strong electrostatic force of attraction or Coulombic force of attraction. Then if constituent particles are atoms that are joined together with the help of covalent bond, then they are called covalent solids or network solids. There is a large network of different molecules, different atoms that are joined together with the help of covalent bonds. Then we come to the metallic solids. These crystalline solids are formed by mainly metals. Herein, positively charged metal ion is immersed in the sea of electrons, and the electrostatic force of attraction that operates between these positively charged ions and sea of electrons forms metallic solids. Now if we come to the properties of different of crystalline substances, metallic solids are conductors of electricity due to presence of these free mobile electrons. As we know that for any substance to be electrical conductor, either there will be free electrons or there will be free ions that are present in their structure. So in case of metallic solids, these free electrons are present, therefore they are good conductors of heat and electricity. In covalent solids, free electrons or free ions, both of them are not present. So they are insulators. And since this covalent bond is quite strong, large amount of energies are required to break these bonds. Hence they have got high melting points, high boiling points, insulators. As an exception to this rule, graphite is a conductor because of a different structure that we will discuss later. If we come to ionic solids, here constituent particles, that is cations and anions, they are held together with very strong electrostatic force of attraction. So they all are solids having very high melting points, and they are insulators in their solid state. In solid state, there is neither a free electron nor a free ion, although they are made up of ions, but these ions has got a fixed position. These ions are not allowed to move freely. So in solid state, they are insulators, they do not conduct electricity. However, when they are dissolved in water or when they have taken in their molten state, these ions are free to move and they conduct electricity in their solid, in their molten state or in aqueous solution state. Now we come to the molecular solids. Here, depending on the nature of molecule, that could be a polar molecule, so the nature of forces are dipole-dipole interactions. That could be a non-polar molecule, so the nature of forces are van der Waals forces. And there could be hydrogen bonded solids like ice, where the force of attraction is hydrogen bond. Now, crystalline solids are true solids, but amorphous solids are considered as pseudo solids or supercooled liquids, because these amorphous solids, though they have got a fixed shape and fixed volume, they maintain certain degree of fluidity. The property to flow is still retained by these amorphous solids. For example, glass. Although if we see from outside, we see that glass objects has got a fixed shape and a fixed volume. So we say that glass is a solid, but the lower part of window panes in very old buildings, the lower part of those window panes becomes thick as compared to the upper part. Why? Because glass is a supercooled liquid, and because of which it has got a fixed shape and fixed volume, but it retains the property to flow. Fluidity is still maintained. And over a period of time, the molecules, they flow under the influence of gravity, and the lower part of window pane become thick. So before we proceed further, there are certain questions I am quite sure you will be able to reply why solids are rigid. Solids are recognized by their rigidity, uncompressible nature. Gases are highly uncompressible, as highly compressible. Large volume of a gas can be fit in a small cylinder, but in case of solids, it's not possible. Say, for example, I am holding this marker in my hands. If I try to squeeze it, if I try to apply force and try to deform it, it's not possible because it is rigid. So question is that why these solids are rigid? The answer lies in the structure of solids. In case of solids, particles are packed very closely. In this way, and intermolecular spaces are very, very less. So, once force is applied, particles inside the solid doesn't have any space to move. Therefore, solids are rigid. Similarly, there is another question that why solids have got a definite shape and a definite volume. Say, for example, I am holding this marker with me and it is cylindrical, so it doesn't change itself, say. It remains cylindrical. Yesterday it was cylindrical, today is also cylindrical. Tomorrow again it will have same shape. So the question arises that why solids have got a definite shape and definite volume. Again, answer lies in the structure of solid. Here, particles of solid, constituent particles of solid, whether it is atom, whether it is molecule, whether it is ion, they all are packed very closely. And there is very strong intermolecular force of attraction operating between these particles. These particles are held together with very strong force of attraction, because of which molecular motion of these particles is not allowed. These particles cannot move freely, they can only vibrate along their mean positions. Since the constituent particles of solid has got a fixed position, thereby shape and volume of solids is also fixed. So I am quite sure with this discussion you will be able to correlate the structure and properties of the solids. In fact, the study of chemistry basically deals with this correlation of structure and properties of matter. As a human being, as a civilized race, we need different type of materials for our different needs. And if we know the correlation between structure and properties, matter with desired properties can be designed. For example, if you need to make a biochemical implant, that should be biocompatible. If you need to make an airplane, so you need a metal which should be lightweight, which should have high tensile strength. But in order to make a sea, we need a metal which should be heavy and doesn't corrode easily, which can withstand the saline water conditions of seas. So for our different needs, we need different type of matter, different type of materials, and they can only be devised by knowing the correlation between structure and properties of matter. Now we come to the next part of this chapter. What is a crystal lattice? What is a unit cell? And how these unit cells are classified? So we come to the another part. crystal lattice and unit cell. We must have seen all those skyscrapers that are made in big cities. Multi-storied buildings, 20 stories, 30 stories buildings, wherein the different flats, different rooms, they are made one above another. And it seems that same structure is being repeated. The place where first floor or ground floor has got dining hall, the 21st floor also has got dining hall at the same place. So we can say that the every story in that building is a repetition of first one. And by repetition of the same structure, same architecture, we get a big building. That is how in crystalline substances, these constituent particles, these atoms, these molecules, these ions, they are arranged in a definite geometrical pattern, and this definite geometrical pattern is extended through X, Y and Z planes, making a huge structure that is called as crystal lattice or simply lattice. So if in simple words, if I have to define a crystal lattice, then I say that it is three-dimensional arrangement of different particles of a crystalline substance in space. 3D arrangement of points in space. Now once I say point, this term point refers to the constituent particle of solid. It could be a molecule, it could be an atom, it could be an ion, whatsoever is the case. But point refers to the constituent particles of matter. So, 3D arrangement of points in space is called crystal lattice or simply lattice. Now, as I had shown, I had discussed this analogy of a building with crystal structure. That entire building is obtained by repetition of the flat that is present in the ground floor. So, there is a small unit, there is a smallest three-dimensional arrangement which when repeated or which when extended along X, Y and Z axes, it gives rise to the entire crystal lattice. So, a crystal lattice is defined as the smallest 3D arrangement of points which, when extended along X, Y and Z planes, generates lattice. This is called as unit cell. For example, if the entire building is a crystal lattice, then individual flats are there unit cells. Let us understand it in a different way.
So here it represents a crystal lattice.
Now if we look closely,
then we see that these are the points. These are the positions of constituent particles. These are the positions of
atoms, molecules or ions.
So this entire arrangement is obtained by the repetition of this unit. This unit is extended along the x, y and z positions, and this entire lattice is being generated. So this is crystal lattice, and only this part is a unit cell. This is crystal lattice, or simply
lattice.
Now this is one lattice which I drawn here. So these are called points.
Point means the position of constituent particles where these molecules, atoms or ions are present,
and these are edges. A, B and C, and these three are interfacial angles called as alpha, beta and gamma.
So these two parameters, edge lengths A, B and C, so this A, B and C represents edge length, and these angles alpha, beta and gamma are called as interfacial angles, and these parameters are used to characterize different type of unit cells. Not only this, position of points is also used to differentiate between different type of unit cells, and on this basis these unit cells are of two types, basic or primitive unit cell and centered or non-primitive unit cells. In basic unit cells or primitive unit cells, points are only present at where they are supposed to be.
They are only present at these corners
of unit cell.
But in non-primitive or centered unit cell,
additional points are also found apart from these points which are present at corners.
In case of a primitive or basic unit cell,
points are only present at the corners of unit cell.
But in case of non-primitive or centered unit cells,
additional points are present apart from corners. So before I close, let me sum up the things that I had explained in this module. I told you that crystalline solids are classified into four different categories on the basis of nature of constituent particle present and nature of forces that are operating between these constituent particles. That could be a molecular solid, that could be an ionic solid, that could be a covalent or network solid, and that could be a metallic solids. In case of crystalline solids, all these constituent particles, which are commonly called as points, they are arranged in a three-dimensional space in a definite geometrical pattern, making a crystal lattice. And the smallest three-dimensional part of this lattice, which when extended along x, y, and z positions to generate entire lattice, is called as a basic or unit cell. This unit cell can be classified on the basis of their edge lengths A, B, and C, and interfacial angles alpha, beta, and gamma, which are evident here. These are the edge lengths A, B, and C, and these are the interfacial angles alpha, beta, and gamma. Or these unit cells can be classified, or these unit cells can be classified on the basis of position of points where these points are present. If points are only present at the corners of the unit cell, then this is called a basic or primitive unit cell. And if additional points are also present apart from the points at corners, then it is called a centered or non-primitive unit cell. Thank you.